That's half the fun of a new house, seeing what people left behind in the attic.
Well, saving on homeowners insurance with Geico's help was pretty fun, too.
Oh, it's a tiny dancer.
They left a ton of stuff up here.
Well, enjoy your house.
Nope. No, thank you.
Geico could help you save on homeowners and renters insurance.
Attics. Attics are kind of strange places, aren't they? Strange spaces. It's like you wonder, what is this doing up here? You know, when I was a kid, my aunt and uncle had an attic, and it was accessed in the hallway of their house in this one of those pull down staircases, you know, that kind of ratchet up into the ceiling, and you'd pull it down, and they let us go up there, and they let us go up there to ride the wheelchair. And when I was a kid, I didn't think about it. We would do wheelies, and you'd go back and forth in the length of the attic, and just how many times you could go back and forth, and whoever did it the most, they were the winner, whatever that was worth. And it didn't dawn on me to go, what is a wheelchair doing up here? Even how do you get it up there in one of these pull down staircases? They're odd places, attics. And as we get into our final episode of Hebrews 11, we now go into the attic of the Hall of Faith. We've been using this, of course, this has been called by many the Hall of Faith, Hebrews 11, the Hall of Faith, where we see these people who have been faithful to God, who were commended by God, God was pleased with these people because they trusted him and relied upon him. And we've been using this kind of analogy of the Hall of Faith as if it were an actual building. So we entered into the lobby and we figured out, kind of got acclimated to what faith is, what it looks like. And then we started the tour. We went to floor one and we saw the ancients and how they lived and what they did. And they pleased God. God commended them. And then we went down to the foundation, way down floor zero, if you recall, if you're part of that. And then, of course, we've toured floor one and two and three and four. And here we are finally, week seven, final episode, Hebrews 11. And we're in the attic. And it's not just floor five, as some of you would have supposed. It's the attic because here we find some oddities. This is not a normal floor for us. We find things that we might not expect to find. And frankly, it might be a little bit like the guy in the Geico commercial where we're looking around and we're like, we might be tempted to go, nope, no thank you. But let me encourage you, don't do that. Engage. Let's take it in, and let's take it in by faith. Let's do a little rummaging around. Let's rummage around in the attic this morning. We're going to read the text. It's verse 32 through verse 40. But I'll give you a little bit of a warning. As we read the text, this text reads kind of like, if you're familiar with this song by Queen, the Bohemian Rhapsody. Maybe I can remember hearing that when I was younger. And it's like you're listening to it and then you think, wait a second, what happened? Did I think about something else for a minute? Because all of a sudden, it sounds like an entirely different song. You know what I'm saying? If you're familiar with that song, you're like, what happened here? This is the same song. Well, this text reads like that. It's like if you're not paying attention, all of a sudden you're like, wait a second, are we still talking about the same thing? You'll catch it if you're paying attention. Let's go to it, starting in verse 32. It says, "And what more shall I say? For time would fail me to tell of Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, of David and Samuel and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, enforced justice, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions, quenched the power of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, were made strong out of weakness, became mighty in war, put foreign armies to flight. Women received back their dead by resurrection. Some were tortured, refusing to accept release so that they might rise again to a better life. Others suffered mocking and flogging and even chains and imprisonment. They were stoned. They were sawn in two. They were killed with the sword. They went about in skins of sheep and goats, destitute, afflicted, mistreated, of whom the world was not worthy, wandering about in deserts and mountains and in dens and caves of the earth. And all these, though commended through their faith, did not receive what was promised, since God had provided something better for us, that apart from us, they should not be made perfect. Wow. Huh? This is very interesting. The attic of the Hall of Faith, where we find some strange things. We find mighty conquerors. And in the same text, we find mighty sufferers. And we're told that they all have one thing in common: faith. They trusted in and relied upon God. Through faith, through trusting in and relying upon God, some conquered. And through faith, through trusting in and relying upon God, some suffered. This is strange indeed. I'm going to liken it, what we found up here in the attic, to a coin. See, I've got this, it's a silver dollar. You don't see these very often. I've had this for quite some time. This isn't just any silver dollar. It's a, believe it or not, it's a 1922 silver dollar. This is back in the day when it was actually minted with real silver. That's real silver. It's worth far more than a dollar at this point. It's 101 years old. That's kind of cool, huh? And what if I were to say to you, hey, I will give you this coin, but I'll only give it to you under this one condition, that if you can figure out how to just put one side of it in your pocket, but not the other side. All of us are working through the mental gymnastics of, could that be done? And the reality is, that can't be done. It's a single unit. To pocket the coin is to pocket both the head side and the tail side. You really can't separate it. And dear friends, our text is like that. Faith is like that. We want the head side, but not the tail side. And yet, our text doesn't afford such a, what do you call it? I was going to say privilege, but that's not the right word. Our text doesn't afford such a choice. This is the attic of the Hall of Faith, friends. This is a challenge for us. Are you up for the challenge this morning? I'm just wondering, are you up for the challenge? Great. Thanks for the affirmation. Excellent. I saw a couple of heads. I'll do this. Yeah. So our text is like this. So let's go. Let's make our way. Let's do a little rummaging around in the attic. Go back to verse 32. And here he's kind of setting the table, right? This first verse is not the main thrust, but he's setting the table as he's winding down his line of reasoning from the whole chapter. He says, and what more shall I say? For time would fail me to tell of Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, of David and Samuel and the prophets, right? So he's already been giving us a concise history. We've talked from the very beginning that he's chronicling through basically the entire Old Testament. And this is where he like hits the throttle and he takes, like, we're taking up a lot of space here in a very little bit of time. This is the concise history of the faithful, if you will, is abbreviated even further. As we've gotten this all along the way. We've been chronicling through this from the beginning, book of Genesis, now all the way through the end, the prophets. And the author says in his opening line, what more shall I say? It's not that he couldn't say more, but that he doesn't necessarily need to say more because his point has been made. Up to this point, it's very clear. His point's been made. God is pleased when people trust him and rely upon him. We get that through the entire chapter. And so now, all of a sudden, in a half a sentence, he covers the rest of the Old Testament. He spent a decent amount of time working through some of the narratives in the book of Genesis. Then he moves on to Exodus and then into the book of Joshua. And now he like just goes for it and he hits Judges and then works his way all the way through the Old Testament to the prophets in a half a sentence. Now, the original audience, being Hebrew people, would have been very familiar with all of this. So when he names these three sets of people, Gideon and Barak, Samson, Jephthah, David and Samuel, when he names them, they were very familiar with these narratives. And they would have easily been able to continue to make the connections that he, the author, has been making all along. They would be able to say, oh yeah, we can see how Gideon pleased God, Jephthah pleased God, Samuel pleased God by faith. We can see that. Now for us, we may not be quite as familiar with those narratives. And so it might be for us an invitation to go back to the Old Testament and read through those stories through the lens of the Hebrews 11 text and through this idea of the faithfulness of God in Jesus Christ, right? So, but the author could say more, but his point's been made. We get it, right? Now, the other thing he says is, given his intended brevity, he doesn't have time to say more. What more shall I say? For time would fail me. If you remember, we started this series all the way back in January, but we started with the benediction in order to establish the norm, kind of the thesis and the norm for the entire letter right at the onset. Because it's at the end in the benediction that we find the reason for his writing. And in that setting, he says, I'm writing to you a brief exhortation. And I know some of you are like, wait a second. If it's taken us until the end of September to just get through chapter 11, how brief was this exhortation? Those aren't right questions to ask. Don't ask those questions, right? In his mind, it's a brief exhortation. And in that, he says, here's what I want you to get, dear Christian. He's writing to believers. And he's saying, you're experiencing hardship. You're beginning to experience sufferings. You're tempted to revert back to your old ways to alleviate that suffering, but don't do it. The thesis of the letter is the God who is faithful to you will see that you are faithful to him. God will see that you are faithful to him. So see it through. Hold steady. See it through. And so his intended brevity here, he says, I don't have time to say more because it would stretch his intentions. He's not trying to give anything more than a concise history, helping them understand that the people of old, the Old Testament saints, if you will, if they could be faithful to God, then these people and we as New Testament believers, as New Testament saints, being redeemed by God, being completely forgiven by God, being brought into his family, gifted with eternal life, indwelt with the Holy Spirit, surely we too, by faith, can be pleasing to God and receive his commendation. So this is where he goes in this opening line. Now he gets, now let's move on to verse 33 and we'll get to kind of the meat of the matter here. So he says in verse 33, who through faith, so he's referencing those people, again, all these Old Testament folks, who through faith conquered kingdoms and enforced justice and obtained promises and stopped the mouths of lions and quenched the power of fire and escaped the edge of the sword, were made strong out of weakness and became mighty in war, put foreign armies to flight, women received back their dead by resurrection. Middle of verse 35. We'll talk about that in just a moment, but that's where this side of the coin ends. I suppose we could call that heads. Heads. The faithful conquer through faith. Let's just flip the coin. What do we call? Heads. The faithful conquer through faith. They conquer through faith. This is attested to from the opening line. Through who? Through faith conquered. These people conquered. And they did so by trusting God and relying upon Him. What do we find here? That faith is the agency through which these things were accomplished. Here, the language changes just a little bit. In the past, throughout the entire chapter, we've got this recurring phrase, by faith, by faith. By faith Abel, by faith Enoch, by faith Noah, etc. By is that preposition that expresses how something came about. Remember, if you were with us, we talked about this is about agency. Agency is the means by which something is delivered. Here we have kind of the fraternal twin of this preposition by. It's the word through. It's communicating the same sort of thing. Through faith, these conquered. When I was trying to describe agency several weeks ago as we were establishing this at the beginning of Hebrews 11, I used a water faucet as an illustration. Probably all of us have at least a water faucet in our homes, whether in our kitchen or in our bathrooms or whatever. So we're very familiar with this. We go over, we turn the knob, or we lift the lever, and voila, here's water. And we say, well, where'd you get that water? And I say, well, I got it from the faucet. But we understand the faucet's not the source. We got the water through the faucet. The faucet is the agency by which this was delivered to us, but there's a source somewhere else. So when we say that these faithful people conquered through faith, it's about agency. Right? We understand that faith is not the source, it's the agency. Faith is the means by which this was delivered, like a faucet delivers water. God here is the source. He is the one who is conquering kingdoms and enforcing justice through those who are trusting in Him and relying upon Him. We shouldn't confuse that. In fact, we mustn't confuse that. God is the source, friends. His power was what was delivering these people, but it was by means of their faith. The Holy Spirit's power is at work, but it's His power through those who exercise faith. So faith is the agency. The faithful conquer through faith. Here's the other thing that we have to see in a text like this is that we've got these nine things listed and they all sound glorious, but then when we think for a moment about it, we realize that adversity preceded the triumph for these faithful people. This is true for each one of these cases. Conquering kingdoms requires the engagement in battles. And enforcing justice requires taking on injustice. And obtaining promises requires perseverance. Stopping the mouths of lions requires facing lions. Quenching the power of fire requires being in the fire. Escaping the edge of the sword requires someone swinging one at you. Being made strong requires weakness first. Being mighty in war and putting foreign armies to flight requires an actual war, and receiving the dead back to life means somebody had to die. Adversity always precedes triumph. Yes, the faithful conquer through faith, but they face this adversity in the process. And while on the first side of this, we go, yes, that's what we want. This is what we want. We'll take hits. This will be great. But even on that side of the coin, it's not all a life of ease and wonderful. There's challenges. In order to be faithful to God, we have to face these things. And I'm not even sure, friends, we could look through this and to each of these scenarios that's presented, we could attach an Old Testament saint
to that. We could say conquering kingdoms requires battles. Well, of course, Gideon did that. And enforcing justice requires taking on injustice. And we could say the prophet Samuel did that. And we could go through each one of these, but that's not really the author's point. He's saying, what more shall I say? Time wouldn't afford. I don't have time to go through all these things. You can make those connections as you study the Bible yourself. But understand this. You can conquer through faith. And maybe we won't face some of these scenarios, but we most certainly face our own. We most certainly face our own things that we need to engage our faith that require us to trust God and to rely upon God, be they personal, business, or otherwise. The question is, are we up for such things? Are we up for such things? See, it's been said before that everyone wants to experience a miracle, but nobody wants to be in the sort of situation that requires one. So while these are the mighty conquerors' heads, now we've got to look at the other side of the coin. Now is where it actually gets really challenging. Now we find out about these mighty sufferers. And it's really interesting, friends, just in case you're not sure about this, it's not just like this common knowledge, but it is, if you don't know, you don't know, but the chapters and verses that we find in the Bible were not a part of the original documents. They're not a part of the inspired Word of God. They were added so that we could find our way around the Bible, so that in a setting like this, somebody could say, turn to the letter to the Hebrews, open up to the 11th chapter and find yourself in verse 35. And we could all do that without this becoming some scavenger hunt. And it's really interesting that the translators and the people that added these chapters and verses in, that they chose to do what they did here in verse 35. Because we would think, wait a second, these are those who are conquering and these are those who are suffering. Shouldn't there be a verse separating those? But that's not what happens. And I don't think they did that accidentally. I don't think they made a mistake. I think they chose to feel the essence of the text, to know what's truly being communicated here, and they left us mid-verse. And this change takes place, like I was referencing the Bohemian Rhapsody, where it's like the song's going along and all of a sudden it sounds like an entirely different song, but it's the same song. This, friends, the change takes place in the middle of verse 35 and it sounds like an entirely different song. And it's hard to, this is hard to grasp. Right in the midst of women receiving their dead back by resurrection, we find these words, some. Some were tortured, refusing to accept release so that they might rise again, reference to the resurrection, to a better life. Others suffered mocking and flogging and even chains and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn in two, they were killed with the sword. They went about in skins of sheep and goats, destitute, afflicted, mistreated, of whom the world was not worthy, wandering about in deserts and mountains and in dens and caves of the earth. This sounds like a different song. It feels like a whole different coin. But this text is one single coin, friends. It's got two sides to it. Heads, the faithful conquer, and they conquer by faith. And tails, the faithful suffer, and they suffer through faith. Don't forget that we are still under the exact guise, the exact premise of what has been done by people in the past through faith. And these people suffered through faith. And while the first batch of people trusting in and relying upon God conquered, the second batch experienced something entirely different, and that through faith. See, some of us, If I wasn't reading directly out of the Bible and I was telling you this, you would think, you'd be saying, what sort of nonsense is this? What sort of heresy is this pastor teaching today? Huh? Except here it is. Which is why it's so important for us to stay in the Bible. So important for us to not hunt and peck our way around in the Bible, but take it chapter by chapter, verse by verse, so that you don't do the unfaithful thing of skipping the verses that you don't particularly like. Ooh, somebody could say amen on that one. Right? Let me ask you this. Does this fit into your idea, even the way I'm asking the question, your idea of the Christian life? Your idea. Like, who cares what our idea of the Christian life is if it's not straight out of the Bible? Does this fit? Some of us, we look at a text like this, like my wife, Jessie, looked at me recently. I say recently, it's been a couple years, so we've recovered from this. But it hasn't been all that long. We've been married for 32 years. 32 years, and just a few years ago, it finally dawned on me to ask her a very obvious question, which in my estimation, I shouldn't even have to ask, but it just dawned on me because we were doing laundry. And we typically do the laundry, like as far as folding it in our bedroom, on our bed, and then we put it away. And I noticed that she was she was fast about this putting away business. And so I thought, well, wait a second. I asked her, I said, hey, babe. I said, when you're putting my socks and t-shirts and stuff away, you're rotating them in the drawer, right? Like that would be what, in my estimation, anybody would do that. If you got a half a gallon of milk in the fridge and you buy another gallon of milk, do you put the new milk in front of the old milk? No, you rotate it. You take the old milk and you put it in the front so that it gets used. So imagine if you only have six pairs of socks only. That's plenty of socks. Have six pairs of socks. And you've worn three of them, and they get laundered and folded, and then they get placed on top of the socks that have been in there the whole time. Now you're wearing out these three pairs of socks while this other three pair just stays fresh and new. Wouldn't you want your clothes to wear out evenly over time? See, to me, I'm thinking, what in the world? This seems very normal to me, as any logical person would. Like I said, we've recovered from this. So when I asked her, you rotate these in the drawers, right? She goes, no. And that was the end of the conversation. But I do as much laundry as anybody in our house. And when I do it, friends, I rotate. Just so you know. But when I asked her this, like it was a legit, I really actually, I wasn't trying to be funny or anything. It was a legitimate question. This is the way my mind works. And she looked at me like I had two heads. Like it was, and she's not being insulting in this, but she looked at me like, that's the dumbest question I've ever. But I actually meant it. And some of us, we look at a text like this, and it's like it's got two heads. And what I'm saying is, it doesn't, friends. It's a single text with a heads and a tails. And as much as we would love to stop in the middle of verse 35 and say, I'll just take heads, thank you so much, legitimately, we don't get to do that, right? The faithful suffer through faith. Suffering has been the experience of many faithful people. And that's where it just doesn't even make sense to us. We say we want to find an excuse for why they're suffering. We want to say, whoa, 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 whoa. These sufferers, they didn't have the same quality of faith. This text does not allow you to do that. This text does not get to pit you, doesn't allow us to pit those who conquer against those who suffer and make a distinction between them in the quality of their faith. This text does not allow us to do that. This text says very clearly, very plainly, some conquered and some suffered, and all of them did it through faith, in the midst of trusting God, in the midst of relying upon God. Suffering has been the experience of many people throughout history. These, dear friends, these are not metaphors that are being presented to us. This is not hyperbole. The author is not describing something using extreme exaggeration to make his point. These are real life events. These are real world events that took place in the lives of people who were faithful to God. Throughout history, many men and many women have experienced what is described in these verses. In our context, where there are legal protections and such, the heat's been turned up over the last couple of years and we've felt it. But when we look at this list, we can kind of feel much more like we've been suffering with hangnails versus real suffering. These are referencing all Old Testament saints because that's part of his argument. He's talking about the Old Testament saints and what that looks like then for the New Testament saints. But the New Testament early saints, oh my goodness, friends, that's why this letter is being written. New Testament, the early church suffered severely, like beyond anything that I would want to describe in detail from the platform, because it's gross and nauseating. And it's really hard to believe. It's hard for us to stomach. One of those early church fathers, you might have heard his name, Justin Martyr. I just read about him recently, and so he was in my head. Justin Martyr was a pastor, leader in the early church, and he and six of his fellow believers were executed by the Roman government in AD 165. They were given the option to recant, to renounce their faith, or be executed. And all of them chose execution over recanting their faith. Justin was the pastor of the church, and he was beheaded in front of his church. Can we imagine such a thing? Not really. Not in our little cocoon. But this actually happened. And just before they lopped his head off, he uttered these words to his church. He said, "Remember, brothers and sisters, they can kill us, but they can't hurt us. Give us faith like that." Huh? Give us faith that is so sure of the promises of God that we're not even afraid of death. Suffering has been an experience for many people. Missiologists tell us that more people were murdered for their faith in the 20th century, for following Jesus, more people in the 20th century than all of the other centuries prior combined. And that doesn't even seem possible to us because of the environment in which we have had the privilege of following Jesus in. But this is the tail side of the coin, and it is real. Another thing we see throughout this letter and throughout this chapter is that suffering is not our choosing. It's not our choosing. How do we know? Look at the text. How do we know if we will escape the edge of the sword by faith, verse 34, or we will be killed with the sword by faith, verse 37. It's in the same passage. How do we know? Well, we don't. We don't know. It's not our choosing. Some of you recall those children's books. This is kind of partly where I started becoming a reader. I think I was like mid elementary age, and I don't know if they were brand new, but it's when I discovered these choose your own adventure books. Like, these are cool books. They're adventure type books, and you're reading along, and at some point it says, you get to choose which direction the story goes. You get to a certain section, and it says, if you want the story to go this direction, go to this page. If you want the story to go that direction, then go to that page. And I'm like, oh, these are cool books, right? So you'd read through them and choose your own adventure, and it was really great. Now, if one of those choose your own adventure books were written for this text, we'd be reading along, and we'd get to a certain page, and we would read, to escape the edge of the sword, turn to page 97. To be killed with the sword, turn to page 102. And none of us would turn to page 102. None of us would choose that. And as we look at the letter to the Hebrews, chapter 11, and these people who went through the things they went through, none of them would have chosen what they went through. And yet they did go through it by faith. Now this side, when they're on this side of their story, meaning they have entered into the promises of God, they have received the reward for having pleased God through trusting in him and relying upon him, they now look back and they go, certainly I see everything that God was doing, and I wouldn't change it. But in the moment, given the choice, you kidding me? I'll take heads every single time. You know what I'm saying? But these people are being led by Jesus, just like anybody who's a follower of his. Meaning Jesus is the leader. He's in charge. The choosing is actually his, and we're not choosing our own adventure. We're not choosing our own path. We're trusting the Good Shepherd, who leads us in right paths for his namesake. And some of those right paths lead to conquering, and some of those right paths lead to suffering. And somehow we walk through whatever that path is by faith. You know, suffering is also a test of genuine faith. And when I say that, that is definitely true in some circumstances, but I don't know that it's always true, that all suffering is meant to be a test of our faith. I actually don't think that's so, that there are other reasons that God either allows or has us go through various types of sufferings. So, but even if the intention isn't there, it still does test the genuineness of our faith, right? And this is hard. So when I read a text like this, it begs some really, really difficult questions. Questions that make you have to kind of come to terms with our version of the Christian life. Questions like, would I love God if I were wandering about in deserts and mountains and in dens and caves of the earth? As the text says, destitute, afflicted, and mistreated. Would I love God if my experience was that I was such an outcast in society, that society had so turned against the faith that I was destitute, afflicted, and mistreated? Would I love God? That doesn't sound anything like the victorious Christian life that we've heard about from the multi-million dollar preachers on the television and the radio. You don't have to say, man. It's true anyway. That's a pseudo-gospel. Pseudo means false. Would I love God? Maybe a more fundamental question. Why do you love God? Why do I love God? If it's because we're hoping to get something from him, that's not really love. Right? I mean, if we use that criteria toward any other relationship, that makes us users. Somehow, we have to love God because he's God. We have to love God because he's loved us. And I know, friends, when we're confronted with a text like this, it's tempting to go, let's find the happy verses. Let's go to those places in the Bible that are the happy verses. And thank God those happy verses are there. It's tempting to want to pretend like that doesn't exist. Like what's in the latter part of Hebrews 11 doesn't exist. It's tempting. In fact, it's even tempting, I hate to say this, but it's tempting for some to hear a message like this and think, maybe I should find a different church. Right? A church that seems to, you know, have those, they always address those happy and airy verses. Where, just, you know, the setting feels like either a concert or a movie theater it feels just a little bit more like a pep rally, you know? And it's the pastor's job to make you feel good and to pump you up for Jesus, right? But that's not my job, by the way. Though I do want you pumped up for Jesus, yes. The problem, it's like... And again, I don't want to be critical, but if it's not right, it's not right. And if we're in a setting, if in our own approach to the scriptures, we're trying to choose our own adventure, or in our search for a church, we want to go to one of those places that make it seem like, hey, we're get to choose our own adventure. It's me and Jesus, I'm in the lead, and he's got my back. That's not the gospel. And if that's not the gospel, then you're not actually following Jesus. You're following a pseudo version, a faux version of Jesus, one that you made up. I know it's tough. That's a problem, right? We should know that. That's a problem. The other problem is that this is not how life works out. So if we just choose the light and airy, the choose your own adventure, that which seems like it's just the best in the whole wide world, but we ignore the other side of the coin, then when we experience the other side of the coin, we're not prepared for it. And we become disillusioned, and that disillusionment sweeps us away. And then you know what happens? I'm saying this like I've actually watched it take place in people's lives before. Then what happens is, the person who's been disillusioned because they never saw the other side of the coin, they blame God for not being faithful to what they tried to hold him to. I said a couple of weeks ago, true faith, true biblical faith responds to God's initiatives. We don't get to make stuff up and then say, now God, here's the parameters by which you can work in my life. It's just not going to happen. Jesus is Lord. So suffering is a test of genuine faith. The other thing that we could say is suffering is evidence of the goodness of God. And that sounds completely contrary, but that's what we get toward the end of the passage. Verse 38 says that the world was not worthy of these people. The world was not worthy of those who were trusting in and relying upon God. It's evidence of God's goodness to them. The presence of these people in the world was evidence of God's mercy and grace, that he had saved them, that he was transforming them, that they were relying upon him because he had given mercy and grace. And most of the time, those folks are turning around and proclaiming this message of mercy and grace to a people who then persecute them and mistreat them, evidence that the world is not worthy of them because they love darkness rather than light. Because their deeds are evil. If that sounds familiar to you, it should. Jesus said that. And the way these faithful people were treated was evidence that the world was not worthy of them. The world was not worthy of the mercy and grace of God, nor those who were bringing it, communicating it to them. So we got this. The sufferers, the other side of the coin from the conquerors, and it's a single coin. But we get down to our last couple of verses, and we find here the end of the matter. And all these, verse 39, and all these, the conquerors as well as the sufferers, and all these, though commended through their faith, did not receive what was promised, since God had provided something better for us, that apart from us, they should not be made perfect. Wow. So the faithful are commended through faith, right? We've got that all along, here again, restated. They were commended through faith, but that's not all that those verses say. There's conquerors, there's sufferers, all through faith, received God's commendation. They pleased God. But they didn't receive all that God promised them. We could probably add parenthetically, not in this life, right? These people died holding on to unfulfilled promises. What? And without complete closure. But they lived by faith. And in the midst of their living, they died. And they died by faith. And for that, they received God's commendation. And I would dare to say, dear friend, that is the most important thing in your life, to receive God's commendation. And the only way to receive it is by trusting him and relying upon him, particularly his testimony about his son, Jesus Christ. So these people, they did not receive all that God promised, not in this life. And all of us want peace and happiness. We know there's more important things in life than happiness, but who doesn't want to be happy? Everybody does. Our culture has just made that the pinnacle of human existence. If it doesn't make you happy, avoid it. And that is antithetical to what it means to be a human. But we all want peace and happiness, but we don't find peace and happiness by always winning. We don't find it by always getting all of our prayers answered. We find peace and happiness by trusting God in the things that are unseen and in the midst of the unfulfilled, because we're looking far enough ahead. So these, they didn't receive all that God had promised. And in our last verse, we see that they were incomplete without us. Yes, they were commended through faith, but they were incomplete without us. That's what verse 40 tells us, which is very strange. Somehow we belong to these who are listed in the hall of faith. We belong to them. Now, it seems that we're so far removed that we can't make that connection, but this text tells us this. And likely in eternity, we'll experience it in its full, but we belong to them and they belong to us. So they're incomplete without us, and we are incomplete without them. Now, the big picture, it's Old Testament saints. Though they're commended, we're incomplete without the new covenant, and thus the new covenant saints, because everything rests and rises on the death and resurrection of Jesus. Right? Without him, everything and everyone is incomplete. He is, as the text says, the something better. God has provided something better. So ultimately, it is all about that, the death and resurrection of Jesus. But as we read this, it's interesting that we get the plural pronouns. Not you and I, but us and we. It's like God is wanting to communicate to us again and again that whatever he's doing is always an us thing and not just a you thing. You follow? God has something better for us than he does for you. So if in your quote version of the Christian life, it's you and Jesus, and not you and Jesus and the rest of the people that are walking with Jesus, you've got a faulty version. It needs to be refined. You will not be made perfect without us. Verse 40. So regardless of which side of the coin we're on, whether conquerors or sufferers, commendation comes from God through faith. Trust in and rely upon him. So back to the silver dollar. What if the offer was heads, you conquer, tails, you suffer? What do you choose? Easy answer. Not a trick question. All of us choose heads, hands down, every day. Of course. But according to this text, that's not the offer. That's not offered to us. Who wouldn't want heads? Who wouldn't shy away from tails? But remember, a coin's a single item with two sides. To take the coin is to take both sides of it. And faith is like that. So what if the offer was heads, Jesus is with you, and tails, Jesus is with you? So whether you're conquering or whether you're suffering, Jesus is with you. Do you take the coin then? You know, Jesus experienced both sides of the coin himself. He was a mighty conqueror, but he also suffered mightily as well. So wherever you're at, whatever you're experiencing, we could say that Jesus has been there and he's with you. Our big idea, the big idea for our text, but probably for the whole chapter, whether we live by faith or whether we die by faith, God will commend us for our faith. Let's bow in prayer. And let me address this from two sides, simple enough. First, if you are a follower of Jesus, begin now, even now, to pray, asking God to refine your faith so that you trust him, heads or tails. In conquest or suffering, begin now to pray and say, God, I want to learn to trust you, to live by faith, whether I'm in the head side of the coin or the tail side of the coin. Let that be your prayer. The others I would address are those who are not yet followers of Jesus, whether participating online or here in the auditorium. If you've not surrendered your life to Jesus, asking God to forgive you, to reconcile you to himself, let today be that day. The invitation from God stands. That if you put your faith in Jesus, believing that he is the one who died for your sins and came back to life, and that by trusting him, you will have eternal life. That's the gospel. So regardless of what you have or haven't done in this life, the love of God is constant in your life, and Jesus would reconcile you to the Father and give you eternal life. Let today be the day for that. If today is the day for that, then tell somebody. Talk to somebody about that. The friend that brought you, somebody with a lanyard on. Even at the very least, make a note of it on your connection card. Let's pray together. Father, I want to thank you for your word. It is alive and active. It's sharper than a double-edged sword. And today, I believe you've been doing some real work, Lord, in shaping and molding our view of what it looks like to follow you, to trust you, to rely upon you. And for some, it's very challenging, and I ask that you give them the necessary grace. For others, it's validating because they've been going through hardships, but they have been trusting you. So give us your grace, Lord. Help us to know that whether we live by faith or die by faith, you will commend us for our faith. Praise your name. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So, friends, that concludes our tour of the Hall of Faith. We've been in the lobby, down to the foundation, floor zero, up on the other floors, and now we've rummaged around in the attic a bit. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. That was the opening verse to the chapter. So as you go today, may you go with that assurance. And may you go with that conviction. Go in faith.